But now it's been what? More than 6 months, right, of this pandemic. So it's really great that you're still interested in your professional development and that you are here today for us to talk about metodologias ativas in our English classroom. For those of you that do not know me yet, I am Daniela Meyer. I am an academic consultant with Cambridge University Press in Latin America South, mostly Brazil. But I have done a couple of teacher training sessions in Chile and in other places as well. So I've been teaching for many, many years. And for the last 12 years that I have been with Cambridge University Press, I have been focusing mostly on teacher training, teacher development. So as I said, it's a pleasure to be here with you once again. And let me see. So let's see if you could see my screen. Let's get a bit of housekeeping organized before we actually start with metodologias ativas. The first and most important thing, as usual, is about certificates. DSAU is issuing the certificates if you registered and if you attend for at least 30 minutes. So make sure that if you really want a certificate or need one, that you stay for at least 30 minutes. They will send it to you on your email address, the one you use to register. The other thing I have to say in terms of housekeeping is that I hope to have the 10 final minutes to have them as a question and answer session. So if you want to ask a question about metodologias ativas or about anything I say during the session, please write your question in the chat box, but with a question mark. Okay, because at the end, I will be able to select all the questions with question marks, and then we can have an interactive session with questions and answers. Oh, and also, this being a session on metodologies ativas, you wouldn't expect me to talk all the whole time alone and lecture you for 50 minutes. So I'm going to ask you to do some pair work. But unfortunately, this platform does not have breakout rooms. Well, it would be very difficult indeed, wouldn't it? Because we've had more than 700 people enrolled. So even if we did have breakout rooms, it would be a bit complicated. So when I ask you to do pair work, I'm going to ask you to do pair work with yourself, which is always a guarantee of an intelligent conversation, isn't it? Okay, then. So hello, everybody that is saying hello in the chat box. I can't answer everything, but I've seen people from São Paulo, from Belém do Pará, from Rio de Janeiro. I am actually now in Petrópolis, Rio de Janeiro. I am at my mother's house. I've been weathering the pandemic here in Petrópolis. Okay? So having said that, oh, can you please do me a favor if you're a chat person and you're going to be interacting in the chat room all the time? If people ask about certificates, can you let them know? Oh, Daniela has explained that the certificate is for people that stay at least 30 minutes and that Gisele is going to be sending that to the other one. Okay? You can also see here my contact information. My phone number, I have WhatsApp in this phone number, and also my email address. Feel free to contact me if there's anything you want to talk about or ask afterwards. All right? So let's go. Glasses on. And here we go. Okay, so if I ask you how much you know about metodologias ativas, don't put the answer in the chat. Do not, please. Do not put the answer in the chat. So I'm going to ask you how much you know. You may know very little, you may know some, or you may give the session for me because you know everything. So I am going to have a little research here with you guys. Don't answer in the chat box. Hello, everyone. So can you see the research questions here on the screen? So you start voting, yes. Now, each person can vote only once, of course, right? So do you know a little about metodologias ativas, some, or a lot? Like, you could give the session for me and I can go talk tomorrow. Don't put the answer in the chat box. Answer here, please, in the pesquisa, in the research. Don't answer in the chat box. Have you answered here? It's okay if you put the answer in the chat box, just as long as you have answered here too. Okay, we have 100 and some answers. We have 186 people attending so far. All right, so I'm going to end the research and let's share the results. So, oops, sorry, I'm always pressing the wrong buttons here. Can you see the results? Okay, I have to go up. There we go. So, a lot of people know very little about methodologies ativas. Some people know some, and very few could give the session for me. I guess that's good, in a way, because then you will learn something, I hope, right? So, when we go back now, it's good to know that you will have something to learn, I hope. So here's the agenda, what I hope to do today, what we are going to do today together. First, we're going to talk about what are methodologias ativas. Then we're going to talk about why. And last but not least, we're going to talk about how to do it in the classroom. And the last 10 minutes, as I said, we're going to have questions and answers. I am not going to go into a lot of depth when I mention certain theories, because that's not the idea here. The idea here is for us to get to the how, which is, you know, the practical aspect of methodologies ativas. Right. So let's start with the what. What are methodologies ativas, right? And now I'm going to ask you to use the chat box. If I ask you methodologies ativas, what comes to mind? Please answer at end. Please write one word in the chat box that you think of when you think of methodologias ativas. I've already seen two answers. Methodology, of course, learner-centered, games, students, their work, projects, tips, autonomy, yes, students as protagonists, PBL, a lot of autonomy, connection, fun, indeed, interaction, participation, innovation, interaction, a lot of interaction, a lot of participation words, self-assessment, yes, projects, gamification. I guess you can teach this session for me if I need it. You are doing fine. Engagement, yes, proactivity. Anybody else? Meaningful learning, development, hands-on. Indeed, all your answers are spot on. So creativity, here are a few answers that I put together, but several of these were mentioned by you in the chat box. So it's the key word that comes to your mind, right? So many of you said students, you said protagonism, you said, center, critical, interaction, engagement, many other things. I included a few words that were not mentioned, like the teacher as mediator, facilitator. There's always a lot of sharing when we use methodologies ativas. The student is the center, so student-centered. I didn't put autonomy here, but I should have. But critical thinking, you're right on. Absolutely great. Good afternoon to those of you that are arriving now. Okay, so moving on. In other words, in methodologias ativas, or when we are using methodologias ativas, the student is the center, the crux, the crucial element, right? This is the reason why we talk about student-centered teaching and student talking time versus teacher talking time, that the student needs to be doing most of the work and et cetera. So that's exactly what you said. And all of this includes participation, meaningful interaction, autonomy, what else did you say? Engagement, work, pair work, group work, and et cetera. Also, I think we can point out that it's also very important to remember that learning is more important than the teaching. And you may be thinking, what exactly do you mean? And I mean that when we start teaching, at least when I started teaching, I would think, okay, I'm going to do pages 3, 4, and 5 today, exercises X, Y, and Z. And that's all I was thinking of in the beginning. And after some time, not a lot, after a little time, I realized that it was much more important for me to focus on what I wanted my students to learn in each lesson. And with Methodologias Ativas, this is even more important, is that we're focusing on the learning objectives, on the students, on what we would like each student to learn. And then, as we said, you mentioned it, and I said too, that the teacher becomes more of a mediator or a facilitator. So Methodologias Ativas in English is called active learning, okay? And so it's the translation is active learning. And here's the definition for you. I'm going to give you 30 seconds to read it. Right? So you mentioned all of this. It's a process where the student is at the center. It's not just what the students are learning, but also how they're learning. And today we're also going to mention a little bit the why, why it is good and important to use Methodologias Ativas. So the students are encouraged to think hard rather than just passively sit there and receive information from the student. Remember that active learning or Methodologias Ativas does not mean active physically, it means intellectual activity, right? We want to nurture the brain, we want to engage them intellectually. Can it have some physical activity? It may in some cases, but that's not absolutely necessary. If you have your students running up and down the class, does not qualify as Methodologias Ativas or active learning per se, right? So the good news is that we have, like, in English language teaching, in our English classes, active learning translates into problem solving. Many of you mentioned that in the chat box. Role plays, debates, group work, also pair work, presentations given by the students, discussions, brainstorming, and some other events, but mostly these. So when we're teaching English as a second language or as a foreign language, we are using all of this at times. We don't use all of this together in the same class. We are already working with Methodologias Ativas or active learning. And so the good news is that ELT, which means English language teaching, and private language schools, PLS, like, you know, cursos de inglês, have been doing this, have been using active learning since the 1980s. Okay? So this means probably that you all have been using and doing Methodologias Ativas or including active learning here and there in your classes based on the course books that you're using since the 1980s. Congratulations. Okay? And we have, right? We have been doing a lot of role plays, a lot of discussions, a lot of debates. We are worried about student talking time. We always want to reduce teacher talking time, we want students to be at the center of the progress. We've been talking about student-centered processes and classes for many years. And of course, we are doing it better every year, right? And nowadays, even more so. But congratulations to us. We have been doing active learning or Methodologias Ativas since the 80s. If you were thinking, I was born much after the 80s, it doesn't matter because it started then and it continues and it gets improved every year or so. And you may have even learned with some active learning activities in your English classes. And now you're teaching, which is great. Still in the what, so we have determined what Methodologias Ativas are. I'm going to use only active learning now, okay? If I say active learning, You remember that active learning is metodologias ativas in English. So you may be thinking, huh, I don't know if my course book has always had, you know, active learning or active learning activities. I'll give you a few examples quickly. Here's a lesson from Super Safari 1. It's one of Cambridge's course book for three-year-olds. In this lesson, they're learning about clothes, few words, because they only learn six words at a time, sometimes four. And then you maybe think, ah, there's no active learning there at all. Right. But here in the teacher's book, you see the box that says extension activity. That's a role play. You're going to role play. It says, draw a shelf on the board, put the flashcards there, and have one student act as a shopkeeper, and the other students come and say, shoes, I like shoes. And then the person is, this is a role play for three-year-olds. So it's active learning. Here's another example from Guess What? Guess What is one of our newer titles for Fundamental 1, or, you know, students at that age. The sound is terrible. The sound is not good. There's a bit of an echo. I'm sorry. Nobody can understand me. I can. Audio is really bad indeed. I can. I get lots of I can. Is the audio good for anybody? Okay, maybe the ones that do not have good audio, you can use your earphones, it might get better. Okay, perfect for some, not good for others. It's not clear, not the best, I'm sorry. I'm going to try to speak a bit louder. Is this okay? All right, so going on, this is an example from Guess What? And focus on the project here at the bottom right side. You have a project there, and that's active learning. Students are working in groups to do a project, okay, a poster in this case. It's for 7, 8 year olds in this case. They're saying that now it's better. Let's see. Yes, I think it's better if you can use the phones. Put some earphones on and it might be better. Here's another example from Interchange. Interchange is a book for young adults and adults. And in this case, the students are going to have to prepare, you know, top travel destinations. They have to work together, agree on what should be the best destination. So this is also active learning. Here's an example from Four Corners. Four Corners is also for young adults and adults. If you look at the bottom where it says speaking, speaking part B, it says group work, discuss your topic, and then discussions, right? Also active learning. There are two examples of active learning. This was taken from Touchstone Level 1. For Touchstone Level 1, you have here on your own. So the student is asked to do an activity on his own and create a clock face and write things. There's also self-assessment, which you mentioned that you correlate self-assessment to active learning. Here's another example from Touchstone, and I hope you can read, but this part where it says you have number one, A, B, and C. C here is down at the bottom, and it says notice. So noticing is encouraging the students to notice the language on their own. So it is also active learning, inductive learning, inductive teaching, right? Here's another example from, this one is from Viewpoint, which is more advanced. The names of the books later, yes. More advanced, Viewpoint is more advanced. And in this case, it says the last activity on the page, D, it says it's about you. And it says, prepare an interview on gift giving in your country. So if the students are going to work in pairs or in groups, they're going to have discussions or to do a brainstorming before they actually prepare the interview. Here's one of my favorites. This is one of our latest titles. This page comes from Own It. It's where our latest title, Own It, is in British English, and Shape It is in American English. And this is the lesson that's about food, right? Level one. So the question is, well, the lesson is called You Are What You Eat. And then after they go through the whole lesson, the last pages, it's the CLIL pages where you work with interdisciplinary issues. The students have to design their own food truck. They're obviously going to work in groups or at least in pairs. And I don't know if you can see, but there are five activities here on the left and then three more on the right. So there are eight activities to scaffold, to help, to support the students and the group in coming up with this project of a food truck, active learning. So somebody asked me to mention the names of the books. I of course, chose several Cambridge titles because I am a Cambridge consultant. So I mentioned Super Safari for young kids, Guess What for 7 to 10 year olds. I also mentioned Interchange, which is in its 5th edition, Four Corners, Touchstone, Viewpoint, and now Own It. Okay? So as I said, our course books and English language teaching has been using active learning for a long time. And so you have probably been using it for a long time too, either as a learner or as a teacher. So if we can recap the what of active learning, we have to remember that learning is an active journey. The more active it is, the more effective it will be. People are different, and therefore they learn differently. So our learners will learn differently in different cases and effects. Reality is the ideal starting point. Why do I say that? Because in the past, when we did role plays, like way in the past, we would do role plays that were really awkward, if not stupid. Such as, imagine you are a cowboy in a bar in Texas, and then the other student is going to be the bartender. Oh, it's okay. Sometimes we have to come up with these things to be able to get the students using some sort of specific language. But the more realistic, the better. We are still going to be doing role plays and all of these active learning activities, but reality is the ideal starting point. And also then that the learners are to problematize. They have to list essential issues, analyze, come up with hypotheses, conclude and share. Sharing is very important when we're doing active learning. Very important, right? So this takes us then to the why. The why, we could talk for 2 hours about the why and all the theory behind this, but this is not my objective here, so I'm not going to go in depth into the reasons why this is important. Thank you, George, for having written the names of the books in the chat box. And that's one, yes. Okay. The biggest reason why we use active learning is because of our learners, right? We have learners are digital. And because learners are digital nowadays, education cannot be just analogic, right? So we have to keep up with them. And also these digital learners, they are doing things. They are creating content. They are sharing content. They are interacting with others in real life. And so then we bring them to class and we ask them to sit down and listen to lectures for 40 minutes, 50 minutes, 90 minutes. Impossible. It doesn't work. So you're probably aware of the fact that we have Generation Y, Generation Z. We already have Generation Alpha if not better, right? So here, this is my nephew, João, and he's probably a generation better already because he was born after 2010. And but if you consider all of your students, most of them are digital natives. And if they're not digital natives, they're digital immigrants. But everybody is working with this. There's Generation Z, Generation Alpha, in between, I always get this wrong. Alpha is those that were born between 1995 and 2010. And there are differences in between them. For example, Generation Z is, they are usually collaborative leaders, they are multimodal, they like Google Forms. Generation Alpha is already virtual, real time, augmented reality. So it changes, right? And technology is a part of their lives. João, my nephew, he is only 3. The other day, I was talking to him and his granny. He calls her honey, so cute, because she says, hello, honey. And he says, hello, honey. So I was talking to them, and she was having trouble getting him to see me on the phone. And you know what this 3-year-old said to her? Granny, like this. Honey, like this. He meant, hold the phone like this so that I can see her. He's only 3. So the first reason why we use active learning is because it's important and it's effective and it speaks the same language of the students that we have in the same class. The second reason is that we need to get them to problematize. So a lot of us are still using or use a version of this presentation practice production framework for teaching languages, for teaching English. And we also have to include this fourth P, the problematize. So this is another reason, because if we only use analogic education, this is not going to help them become, not necessarily going to help them become better citizens and critical thinkers. Am I missing something? No. The other reason, there's a third reason now that we should encourage and we should be encouraged to use a lot of active learning in class is this. Are you familiar with this? 21st century skills? It's not a mistake. I typed it upside down on purpose to activate your brain. Okay? So, if you know what, if you're familiar with 21st century skills, please write one of the skills in the chat box. Just one of these. Don't write that. I already have 3 from my emails, but that's okay because I have, yes. Yes, critical thinking, collaboration, communication, creativity. There are other suggestions, learning to learn, critical thinking. So you know what most of you know what 21st century skills are. If I can summarize this quickly, because we could talk about 21st century skills for 2 hours if we wanted. 21st century skills are the skills that are necessary for life in the 21st century. They were actually always necessary, but they are more necessary nowadays because students are getting a lot of screen time. And that does not mean that they know how to think critically or that they are global citizens or that they are effective learners, right? So Cambridge has put together a list of these life competencies, right? Because there are many life competencies, there are many different frameworks, and so we collected all the competencies that were being talked about as life competencies for the 21st century, and we put them together in a document. It's called the Cambridge Framework for Life Competencies. And it's really important that we teach students that as well, creativity, critical thinking, digital literacy, learning to learn. what else? Communication, collaboration, emotional development, and social responsibilities. So all of this is intertwined with the teaching of English. And it has to be, because it's more important nowadays to be able to collaborate well in groups and to communicate well and to be creative than to just know the subjects, right? So this has to be incorporated. It's another reason to use active learning. If you're interested in looking at this document, here's the link, and you can always ask Dr. Google. If you type the Cambridge Framework for Life Competencies, you will see the document. You can download the brochures, the leaflets. There are explanations, suggestions, and ideas. Okay, so if I put together some of the life skills or the life competencies, we come to learner autonomy that many of you mentioned. If we put together learning, collaboration, and critical thinking, just to mention three of the life skills, then the intersection there leads to learner autonomy. And the more active learning they do in class, the more autonomous they will become, our learners. There's also, I'm going to skip over this a little quicker than I wanted. The other reason why we should be using active learning a lot in the classrooms is that the learning experiences have to be significant. The more significant, the more relevant they are, the better they will be remembered. You probably know that active learning comes from constructivism and social constructivism, and the learning experiences have to have a solid base, like these pyramids. And this brings me to the other three pyramids that we could talk about when we're talking about learning. Learning is related to behavior and memory, and also the learning strategies and ways that people learn. So there are three pyramids to consider, right? And this is going to be really fast because we don't have time to go into detail. So the first pyramid to consider is Maslow's pyramid, that the student's physiological needs, safety needs, the love needs, self-esteem and actualization, they are very important. There is no learning if, for example, a physiological need is not met. Like if the student is cold or hungry or doesn't have enough clothes, learning doesn't happen. There's Bloom's taxonomy, or Bloom's pyramid as well, that mentions the fact that the way our memory works, right? First, we remember, understand, and apply, and then we get to analyze, evaluate, and create. Imagine the classroom, the English classroom. If you want your students to create a menu, say, for that food truck that I mentioned, are they going to be able to create a menu if they cannot remember the names of the food in English? No. So they have to do the remembering, understanding, and applying first, and then they move on to the higher order thinking skills that are more in terms of analyzing, creating, and evaluating. Here are some examples of higher order thinking skills where students are asked to create, evaluate, and analyze. All of these that are on top, they are higher order thinking skills, and that means active learning. They need to be able to do the sections that go below that. But here are some examples. Look, here they are creating posters, a drum, food families, animal families, I'm sorry. This one is about analyzing. Is this toy electric or not electric? For seven-year-olds, so this includes higher order thinking skills, active learning. We want their brains to be active, to be involved, right? How about this one? This one is for six-year-olds. If they have to look at the pictures and determine which ones are toys. So this is also analyzing, and analyzing is higher order thinking skills, which means that they have to, you know, it's going to activate their memories better. So as I said, your textbooks probably already have a lot of active learning without you realizing it, that these activities were active learning. Remember that students must Maslow before they can bloom. What I said was, remember, if a student is hungry, he or she will not learn well, or will not learn, period. There's also a third pyramid, which is Glasser's pyramid, which says, if I lecture you the whole time, it doesn't work. You only remember 5%. By reading, you remember 10%. If there are audio visuals like myself here today, you may remember 20%. If there's a demonstration given by either the teacher or the student, you will probably remember only 30%. But if there's a discussion group, practice by doing or teaching others, then the students will retain much more, much, much more. So I would like to ask you to take a minute to do the pair work with yourself that I had mentioned. Remember that I said that students have to bloom, to Maslow before bloom. So if I go back here to the Maslow pyramid, try to think of a difficult student that you have nowadays. If you don't have any difficult, not just because of the pandemic, let's think pre-pandemic, but still, if you want to think of a difficult student with the pandemic, you can, but it's going to be different issues. Try to think of a different student, difficult student you had last year. Can you, and talk to yourself, can you think, can you identify any of these needs in the Maslow pyramid that were not met and that were probably the reason why he or she was difficult in the first place? This is the talk to yourself time. I'm not going to take too long with this, but you can analyze your difficult students later on and see if, you know, do they have enough friendship? Do they have, are their safety needs being met? Is their self-esteem, respect, status, recognition? How about air, water, food, shelter? All of this has to be taken care of before they can effectively learn. So we've given the examples of, so remember, so if we go, just going back to Glasser's pyramid quickly. So the more active the students are intellectually, the better they will remember things. The more meaningful will be the learning. Okay, now we're going to move to the how. And the how. How can we include more active learning in our classes? Because as I said, we usually, there are lots of active learning moments or activities in your course books already. But so the first thing you have to look at is your course books and your extra components and your materials, okay? What is there that can be considered active learning? Can you adapt? Can you expand? Do you need to tweak it to make it relevant to your students? But you don't have to reinvent the wheel every class. So I am sure your course books, just like Cambridge course books, are going to have some, perhaps many, active learning activities and, you know, suggestions and ideas. So take a look at your course books. Second tip for how to include or to have more active learning in your classes is ask yourself when you're planning, can my learners do this instead of me? For example, if the learners can do something instead of you, it's better because they're going to be more involved. They may be discussing, brainstorming, analyzing, studying, finding out, and it's better than you doing the talking. You may be thinking, huh, but how do I do this with English, as English is the subject here? I'll give you an example. Many years ago, I think it was 2007, I was still working at Ibeo in Rio de Janeiro, And I had a class because we had started, you know, putting internet connection in the classroom. And so I was teaching a Saturday group. And I had to teach for adults. And I had to teach 12 or 20 clothes words, you know, like shirt, blouse, flip-flops, hat, this, that, and that. And I thought, this is going to be very boring. How am I going to do this? So what I decided to do that is considered active learning is I took to class picture dictionaries, real dictionaries. It was free Google. I mean, Google was already there, but it wasn't that well known and not everybody used it. So I took books, dictionaries, picture dictionaries, and also I linked, you know, connected my computer to Google. And I said, okay, get together in groups. You have 7 minutes to learn all of these words, figure out what they are. Their books also had pictures, right? Illustrations. So you see, I was there mediating, helping. And after a while, a very young adult came and said, may I use your computer? And I said, yes, of course. So he would say, okay, what's the word we don't know yet? Flip-flop, flip-flop. He would go to Google and find an image. That was when I learned that you could find images on Google. So you see, bear this in mind. Can my learners do this instead of me? It will probably, you know, be more active and more engaging and more effective than me just giving them lectures. What else? Okay, the other way you could do it is you think about how we can help learners become better thinkers, and also how we can help students become active learners. Once again, remember, intellectually active, not just physically active, right? And I'm going to ask you to do something too, because it would be best if I could. It's a task for you. Oh, yes. I would like you to go to Google and type in thinking routines. Type in thinking routines. Thinking routines. And see how many hits you get, please. And tell me here in the chat box, because my interactive whiteboard is not working. Thank you. Okay? Wow. I got 92 million. Thinking routines, 92,200,000. Anybody that got more than that? 92,533,000. Okay. So that's the idea. One of the ways that we have to help students become better thinkers and better learners, and perhaps even a long time, lifelong learner, is to use thinking routines, to help them with thinking routines. When I did this search, I got 434 million results. I'm sorry that some people do not have good sound. Maybe you can use an earphone and it might be better. Millions and millions, 656 million. So why am I talking about thinking routines? Because that's a very good way to get students to become better thinkers and more effective learners. So what do I mean by thinking routines? Have you ever tried think, pair, share? Whenever I have to give a pair work, instead of saying just talk to your partner about your typical day, a routine day, I used to do that in the beginning, and what happened was, I don't know. So I changed when I learned this think, pair, share routine. First, I tell them, think about your typical day, your routine day. After they have learned the words and effects, so I give them 30 seconds to think. After I give them 30 seconds to think, I put them in pairs. They share their typical day. And I tell them, pay attention to your friend's answers or to your peers' answers. And then later, they're going to have to share the answers with another person. They're going to have to tell another partner what they learned from my typical day. So this is one thinking routine. There are millions of others, as you saw. Now, I wanted to share with you two of my favorites. So your next activity, your next, yes, that's nice, Vanessa. Your next activity is going to be that I am going to suggest two of my favorite sites for learning, for thinking routines. And I'm going to give you 3 minutes to choose one of these sites and look at one thinking routine. Okay? So I'm going to repeat. I will show you 2 sites for thinking routines. They are my favorite at this moment. And you will have 3 minutes to go to one of the sites and choose one thinking routine and read about it. Okay? Can I share? I'm going to share them here on the screen and also in the chat box. Hopefully this will work. There. So you can either go to We Are Teachers or Think Fair Share Alternatives or Project Zero, Harvard, thinking routines. Choose one of these 2 sites and one thinking routine and read about it. Please, 3 minutes. We have 1 more minute. Okay, may I ask you to come back, even if you haven't finished? Your homework is going to be try to think about how you're going to incorporate one new thinking routine in your English classroom, okay? And that is also an active learning kind of activity. If we had breakout rooms, I was going to put you together with a partner and then you would exchange what you learned. So you learned one activity, somebody else learned a different thinking routine, you exchange ideas. Because I try to do this as active as possible because it would be very incongruent, right? To have an active learning session and me doing all the talking for 50 minutes. But we have to work with the platform that, you know, the features that the platform has. So remember, for homework, try to imagine a way to incorporate the thinking routine you learned about in your next class. And because it's 10 to 5, and I said we would have some time for questions. Oh, why doesn't this go forward? There we are. So to wrap up, active learning is powerful, is excellent for us to go from bored, sleepy students. And that usually happens when we're doing a lot of talking and they're not being asked to think at all, to having engaged, interested students that participate. And that will remember much more, and that will be much better. Remember that this is what they do in their real life outside the classroom. So if we ask them to come to the classroom, power down, sit, and listen to us for hours, be it when they're 3-year-olds or 17-year-olds or adults, it's very boring and very difficult to stay connected. So do it as often as you can. Include more active learning in your classes. Okay? So now I am going, if you have any questions that you have not yet asked, please write them in the chat box with a question mark so that I can, you know, choose them. And publish them here for everybody to see. So let's see, I go now here, Modo de Perguntas. Okay, all right, so here's one question by Priscila Rocha. Thank you very much, Priscila. This is very interesting. Can guided discovery be considered active learning? Yes. Indeed, it would be, yes, you're going to guide them through the discovery of some topic. In a way, it's kind of like what I suggested. I mean, my activity, my active learning activity with the scavenger hunt for the clothes that I was teaching was sort of like a guided learning, but for really low-level students learning English. But definitely, guided discovery has, you know, guided because the teacher is acting as a guide, and the teacher will always act as a guide or as a mediator, as a facilitator, but it definitely is active learning. Yes. Thank you very much, Priscila. I have some questions that oh, Priscila asked, this is not a question, sorry. Let me see if there are other questions here. There's a question about my slides. Rosana Maria de Sá Campos. Thank you very much, Rosana. I'm pleased that you like the session. I don't think we share slides. We don't. But the session is being recorded, and it will be available in the Zalt channel on YouTube. I think as of next week, if I'm not mistaken. So you can watch again. All right? Thank you very much. Here's another one, Vera Hauta. Thank you, Vera. Very interesting questions. How can I work with active learning in the kindergarten? I don't know if you were here, Vera, when I showed an example from Super Safari, which is one of Cambridge's titles for three-year-olds. And with three-year-olds, when you're teaching clothes, we have flashcards. And you can even get them to help you make the flashcards or color in with flashcards. Of course, active learning changes according to the student's age. But the example I gave was that was actually for kindergarten, for three-year-olds. They can do role plays, right? They are going to be able to role play being in a shop, and one person says, you can even use paper money or fake money if you want. So there are many ideas. You can have them, there are many role plays that you can play. You can have them analyze, like I gave an example of, is this clothes or is this animal? Or, you know, of course it's going to be limited and low level, but you can use it in many different ways. And one suggestion I have is that you look at the Cambridge Framework for Life Competencies, and we explain and give lots of suggestions for the different stages of the learning journey. Okay? Thank you. Let me see if there are other questions here. Oh, yes, there are. Good. This, I like. Okay, here's one. Larissa Nazário asks about how we can motivate beginner students, especially adults. Motivation is another subject that could take forever, that we could discuss it in 6 months at the university or in 2 hours. But active learning is really about motivating. The more active the students are, the more intellectually involved, the more challenged they are, the better it is for them. Think of yourself, Larissa. Do you like going to a session where you are asked to sit and listen to the person talking for 50 minutes? People start thinking about other things, you know, making shopping lists, what I need to buy at the supermarket, or making playlists. It's impossible. The brain doesn't work that way. So I believe that if you involve your students with discovery, with learning, with finding things on their own, with challenges, giving them choice, especially adults, they're going to enjoy that and they're going to be more motivated. There's another one here. I'm not reading the questions before, so I'm just picking them. Let's see, Fernanda de Souza Brissa. How can we have more active learning in regular schools, where the students are in many different levels? The good thing about active learning, Fernanda, is that, remember I said at one point, one of the slides says, people are different and they learn differently. It's very good, actually, when you have different levels. You just have to make sure you group them in different ways. Sometimes you may want the ones that know more together in one group for certain activities. And other times you might want to mix them all up, right? So it's actually very good that you have different levels, because then not necessarily the one that knows more English is the one that's going to be best at analyzing or researching or keeping time. So you can establish different roles for group work and try to use as many ideas as you can. The first thing to do is identify the active learning activities or moments in your course book, and then tweak it or adapt it accordingly for your students. I think we have time for one more question, and it's going to be like eeny, meeny, miny, mo. Here we are. Where is it? Ah, here. This question is from Maria Victoria Palhares. Thank you very much, Maria Victoria. Is it possible to have active learning in business English classes for adults? It's possible to have it everywhere. What's the important thing? Bear in mind one of the suggestions I gave. When you're preparing your class, think, do I have to do this part or can my students do this on their own? Can you have a flipped classroom moment in the class? And that's appropriate even for online classes, as somebody has asked you in the chat box. So it's business English classes, yes. Nowadays, there's Google, Google Images, Google Pronunciation, Google Translation. You can ask them, put them in groups, and have them figure out something on their own. If there's a reading, how many of you have done jigsaw reading? If there's a reading, instead of having the whole class do the reading, or even worse, you read the reading for them as if you were William Bonner, you can have them, you know, divide them into little groups and have each group read a paragraph, and then you divide them again, and then they have to tell each other what they read about in their paragraph. So this can be done in any class, even in business English. I know that there are many other questions there. It's a pity I'm not going to have time to answer all the other questions. I would like to say thank you very much for your presence, for your questions, for your interaction in the chat box. Feel free to send me your questions either by WhatsApp or email if you want to, you know, me to answer your questions, and I didn't have time to do so in this 10-minute question and answer session that we had. Okay? Thank you very much for being here. It was a pleasure. Remember, the more active your students are intellectually, the more you nurture their brains, the more interested and engaged, motivated they will be. And therefore, the more they will remember. Okay? Happy teaching. Enjoy your teaching. And I hope to see you soon. Bye.